Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to TPA's webinar on BEPS Action Plan 13 and its influence on Pan-Latin American multinational corporations. We have two speakers for today's event. Our first speaker will be Hebert Guevara. He's a project manager at Transfer Pricing Associates. He initiated his career in the banking industry and then made a move to transfer pricing 8 years ago. He's previously worked in Mexico, US, UK, and now is practicing in the Netherlands. Hebert's experience in the Latin American region includes reducing M&E's compliance costs for preparing transfer pricing documentation for their Latin American operations, ensuring that intercompany arrangements are sustained by economic, financial, and legal arguments, and simplifying the reporting to the MNC's top management of transfer pricing and tax-related matters with relation to their business operations. Our second speaker will be Virinder Sharma. He's a partner with Transfer Pricing Associates. He has previous 15 years of work experience. He has previously worked in India, UK, and is now practicing in the Netherlands. He will be the moderator for our presentation today. Just a few rules before we begin. We would like you all to keep your questions for the end. You can type in all your questions, and I will read them out as when we reach the end of our presentation, and they will be answered by one of our speakers. I now give the floor to Hebert.
Thank you, Avisha. Thank you, Miranda, for participating with me on this event.
Thank you,
everyone, for joining us today. And I hope that the purpose of this presentation will be in line with your expectations. And if I can give you a little bit of background as to why we decided to come up with this webinar, it's because of the changes that the BEPS project have introduced around the world. And in particular, my clients have been asking me what will happen for Latin America, and if we focus just on Action Plan 13, what would be the effect? So that's the purpose of this presentation, to give to all the audience a little bit of guidance of what you can expect from the BEPS project, Action Plan 13, in the context of the Latin American Caribbean region. So if we focus first on the content of this presentation, I would first like to start talking a little bit about the purpose and benefits of this presentation. Then I would like to move a little bit to the relationship that the Latin America region has with the OECD. That is important for you to understand, as you will see how much influence Latin America has in all OECD projects, in this case within the context of Action Plan 13. For those listeners who are not that familiar with Action Plan number 13, I will provide a brief background of what it is. Then we're going to move to the Latin American countries and which countries we see leading the implementation of Action Plan 13. Then we're going to move to the solutions. How can you find a solution in terms of Action Plan 13? What can you do about, given the resources, given the information available, and given the guidance that tax authorities across LATAM have been publishing as at the date of this webinar? And finally, like Avisha said, we will welcome your questions at the end of this presentation. Avisha would read them, and then I will be keen on answering them. So we start discussing about the purpose and benefits of this presentation. This presentation is not going to address any technical things about databases or transfer pricing methodologies specifically to Latin America. Instead, I would like to give you a holistic approach. What would be the suggested approach that all multinationals should undertake for Latin America, and again, within the context of Action Plan 13. I would like that at the end of this webinar, you can see that there can be a pan-regional approach that is cost-effective, that is efficient in terms of the people who will be involved in preparing all the levels of documentation that Action Plan 13 suggested. That there will be consistency across the group, across the various transfer pricing reports for all countries where the group operates, not just for Latin America. And in the end, you will hopefully see the benefit that this path towards the market in general. Next slide, please. So most of the audience is most likely in one of these levels that you can see in this first slide. If we see within the circle, we see four layers. So one of you can be either part of the board of directors, a stockholder, or a stakeholder. That means that you have questions from the market. You have questions from your investors. You have questions from financing institutions who are lending funds to your organization about BEPS. BEPS is a new subject. Not everyone is expert on that. But you have questions, and in the end is, are you prepared to answer those questions? And if you answer those questions, what would be the potential impact that they would have in terms of the perception that the market has on your organization? If you're also a CFO, if you are the CFO, then your question is, well, it sounds like I have to do a lot of compliance things. I need to change my organization, I need to close business, open business, restructuring, and so on and so on. In the end, it sounds more like costs. There are high costs, there's no money, the markets, the global market is just finally moving to the green light, but then how can you minimize those costs to be compliant with BEPS? If you're a tax director, the question is, how much knowledge do you have about BEPS? And also, can you come up with a regional approach as opposed to doing country by country? Which most countries are doing, most companies are doing it that way, which is burdensome. It takes a lot of time, it's tedious, and you have multiple advisors. And finally, if you have an in-house transfer pricing manager, you probably empathize with my comments about every single year in Latin America, you have to produce documentation. It costs you. Most of the times, you have different advisors, everyone telling you different stories. You have to produce reports which sometimes are inconsistent amongst each other, duplication of costs, and so on and so on. So the question is, how do each of these four layers address BEPS? And again, if we focus on Action Plan 13, how do you address Action Plan number 13? In the end, there are four key questions that you always need to take into account. What are the expectations of your company? What are the expectations that your investors have? What is the perception that the market has on you, that the people working with your company and for your company have in terms of being compliant with BEPS? What is the long-term plans that the organization have around BEPS? Again, if BEPS will create a little bit more burdensome towards companies, and some companies perhaps will see their taxes going up, what will be your long-term plan? In the end, you need to survive. How do you have a long-term plan? And finally, is communication. It's just all about communication. But if we see these four levels, what's the level of communication that these four levels have amongst them?
Evan, just one point I want to add here is that if we just step back and we look at this situation before BEPS action plans, they were proposed by the OECD. For us, yes, transparency was a very important compliance matter. But since we have these BEPS action plans being rolled out almost 2 years back, now when we see that we have 15 action plans in place, although the topic for us is today is on BEPS action plan 13, but today what data we provide in that three layers of documentation, as Abbott mentioned, we also have to be mindful of that, how the data is presented, whether compliance is met or not. At the same time, that will also have a bearing on the other action plans. So, although we are discussing Action Plan 13 today, but it also have relevance for all other action plans. The output of the data which we see today in C-by-C and also in Masterfile, which has their own peculiar format and the data requirements as it came out in the final C-by-C publication by the OECD on 5th October.
That is correct, Rand. I mean, you mentioned that there are 15 action points. Today we're going to focus just on one. But still, it's very important for the audience to understand what can we expect from Latin America in general, just about BEPS. And I think that if we see on this slide, BEPS is organized by a group of countries, a lead group of countries, developed countries. And if we just focus on the number of Latin American countries that are part of BEPS, we only have two. So that means that from all the Latin American and Caribbean countries, only two Latin countries are the voice of that particular region. So one of the questions that you may want to think is, well, how much impact can these two countries have on the whole OECD project? And how much impact BEPS measurement will have also in Latin America, considering that the majority of Latin American countries do not follow the OECD. They must not follow because they are not part of the OECD members. This BEPS project is also pushed by the G20. And again, if we focus on the G20 country, only we have Argentina, we have Brazil, as members of that. Of course, we have Mexico. But again, we start seeing that there's not that much influence of Latin America on what the BEPS is proposing. And probably most of you have seen it already. If you start looking for information about BEPS Latin America, BEPS Brazil, BEPS Argentina, BEPS Chile, there's not that much information in public. Why? Because these Latin American countries are first looking at what the developed world is doing and then be more in a reactive mode.
But again, when I look at this now, we have two Latin American countries who are the OECD members. But at the same time, when I look at kind of a term which I saw a couple of years back on big countries, which has Brazil, Russia, India, and China, and there was kind of a group where, you know, the emerging markets, they were discussing their own concerns in terms of how the economic growth will happen, how they're going to be in the next few years. But when I look at BEPS, yes, the BEPS has addressed concerns of the developed countries as well as of the emerging economies, which many of them, they are not part of the OECD. But what is your experience has been that even before BEPS, even today, do you think these Latin American countries, and as we know that most of them, they're not OECD members, do they still have a dialogue with emerging markets in Asia, and especially in terms of how they look up to the UN guidance? Because we are talking about action, BEPS Section 13, which is by the OECD. So where do you see, you know, their concerns being addressed? They're part of the emerging markets, and they may have some inclination to look up to the United Nations, and as the as India has, where I've spent many years. So where do you see today that although they have two OECD member countries in Latin America, and they can look up to those two countries, but at the same time, they still have other emerging markets, and which some of them, they follow the UN model. So what's your take on your experience working in Latin American countries?
I think that you know, what Latin America is fearing right now is that BEPS, again, because it's really led by the EU, it's led by the US, it's led by Canada, by Australia, Japan, and all the, those developed countries, they're feared that all the BEPS initiatives are not really going to be on the best interest of LATAM. BEPS is just about corporate income taxes in the end. And what happens in Latin America is that the tax authorities, they live from corporate income taxes as opposed to the developed world. The developed world lives from the taxation of on corporations, but also on income tax. You have wealthy individuals in the developed world as opposed to in Latin America, where most of these people, you know, they run informal businesses, so they don't pay taxes. They don't have a high money to pay in the end. And also because in the developed world, they also live from VAT, so consumption taxes. So, and again, in Latin America, if most of business are done informally, then the government is not collecting enough as opposed to the developed world. So what you can see in Latin America is that they really fear that BEPS would just be a way for companies to scare foreign direct investment in Latin America or actually just in other emerging economies. You mentioned, is there any communication among emerging economies between Latin America and perhaps Asian? To be honest, that has not been the case. I know that in Latin America, earlier this year in February, there was a meeting between regional economies of LATAM. The meeting was held in Peru, and the purpose of this meeting was just to address BEPS. The purpose was to think about what would be the focus of Latin America towards BEPS. I read the paper, I read the summary, and unfortunately there was no such approach determined by Latin America for each action plan. It was more a report about what Latin America thinks in general about BEPS, the areas where they see that BEPS may or may not work, but the report or summary didn't provide a true indication of what would Latin America do and how would they gonna do it. For instance, if we focus on Action Plan 13, there was no indication on how they're going to do country-by-country reporting, at what time, what would be the guidance, who to consult. There's no information about that.
The one point which I would like to see, and I think that should take the right shape in the coming months and possibly a year or 2 years period, is that Action Plan 13 is, yes, we're talking about is compliance. We should have master file. We should have local files. We should have country-by-country reporting. But the most important thing will also be that what concepts are followed by the Latin American countries, and those concepts produce primarily the first two layers, which is master file and country files. So my view would be that if the Latin American countries, they follow the OECD guidance in letter and spirit, then yes, there would be justice to the creation of master file and especially local files, because that's a local subject. So what's your experience has been over the last couple of years? are they really abiding by the guidance given by the OECD? Like my experience again in some of the emerging markets has been that there are own local regulations. They have their own peculiarity. Like in certain countries, you have, for example, arithmetic mean as a central tendency rather than having a range. So, what do you think? Looking at Action Plan 13, do you think will there be an alignment with the OECD guidance from an overall perspective?
That's a very good question, Brianda. For instance, if we focus on the slide that we're showing right now, if you look, there are 26 Latin American Caribbean countries, out of which only two, Mexico and Chile, are OECD members. So in principle, they are required by the OECD to follow what the OECD is proposing, of course, with some local flavor. However, as we're going to see later, only one country from these two has been actively participating on BEPS, at least in the context of Action Plan 13. Because we also have Chile, and for instance, Chile has also been addressing measures. They published this measure last year, in the end of 2014, that have direct import towards BEPS. It has to do with income capitalization, for instance. It has to do with the deductibility of interest rates also. So these two countries are addressing BEPS. Both are not addressing them parallel. And they're not focusing at the same time on the same action plan. We focus on other key markets, for instance, Brazil. Brazil is a G20 member, and it's also a key partner of the OECD. But what that means is that Brazil participates in these meetings and these consultations issued by the OECD. However, it has a more passive role. If you think about how Brazil has been performing economically over the last year, it has been leading the whole Latin America region. If we mix the GDP between Mexico and Brazil, it accounts for more than 50% of the whole GDP of the Latin America region. And Brazil has at least, let's say, 60% of that percentage. So that means that Brazil is in a very good position. They can make up those decisions. They are a very protectionistic country around it. So what they see on BEPS, they're certainly taking it into account. But for now, they have the hand, you know, above. They can lead the market along with Mexico. The problem is that Brazil's economy has been gradually slowing down. What that means is that at some point, the company is not growing as fast as before. Other countries like Mexico, like Chile, they are growing faster. Colombia, for instance, Colombia has been invited by the OECD to be part of this elite group of countries. So that means that little by little, more Latin American countries are looking to be part of this group. So that means that probably they will be more aligned to what the OECD is proposing in this BEPS action plan. But in the meantime, it looks more like Brazil is going to be adopting, as it has been done in the past, its own way towards transfer pricing.
Yeah, that's the point, because, you know, when I look at Brazil, they have kind of safe harbor pricing mechanism in place. An MNC has to look at a kind of a fixed markup. If they get it, say, cost plus 15, yes, everything is fine. But then when I look at the Action Plan 13, when you look at it, there you have a kind of a fixed template. You have to supply information. And then again, we have the whole BEPS Action Plan out now. We have Action 8 to 10 on intangibles and low value adding transactions, and other things are covered. So do you think this BEPS Action Plan 13, looking at other action plans which we are discussing here, do you think that that's going to change the pricing approach which we see in Brazil, which is a very significant part of the Latin America? Would they change the way they look at their transpricing mechanism, because that's kind of a fixed markup approach? But in today's world, we are all talking about substance, we are talking about sharing information in country-by-country reporting, which can be used by the tax authorities for initial risk assessment.
That is correct. The thing with Brazil is that Brazil, as I mentioned, it has its own way of doing transfer pricing. In other OECD countries or even non-OECD countries, you have a transfer pricing report that comprises a company analysis, industry analysis, functional analysis, economic analysis, benchmarks, and so on. In the case of Brazil, that's not required by the law. It's just a series of calculations based upon prescribed markups, like you mentioned, which are set by the government, and that's it. So at least from a Brazilian transfer pricing perspective, again, BEPS Action Plan 13 has nothing to do. It has no relevance for now. And I think that in the upcoming at least 2 to 3 years, Brazil will probably first look and wait to see how action plan 13 works elsewhere in other countries, OECD, especially countries that have implemented, Australia, Spain, the UK, and Mexico, for instance. So they're probably going to be a little bit more reactive again. Let's see how it goes for other countries. Let's see how the world, how the whole world reacts to action plan 13. Let's see how Latin America reacts. Let's see what happens in Mexico. And then depending on that, perhaps Brazil will adopt a measurement. Brazil is focusing on BEPS measure, but certainly not the Rand Action Plan 13 because of the reasons I just mentioned. But it's also like Chile, they're focusing more about interest rates, financial arrangements, hybrid mismatches. That's where Brazil is focusing now. For the audience, if we start talking about Action Plan 13, some of you perhaps are not that acquainted with what Action Plan 13 tries to address. And it tries to address one key point, which is, again, documentation. If you are a transfer pricing manager or you're the head of transfer pricing, head of tax, you probably know that in Latin America, most countries require transfer pricing documentation to be prepared annually for each subsidiary that operates in the Latin America region, depending on some threshold established by the local regulations. But what Action Plan 13 is trying to do is trying to simplify their approach by first proposing a master file. First, let's have a master file, then let's have a country file, and then let's have the country-by-country reporting. And if we can add another layer, that will be the local transfer pricing forms. And what Action Plan 13 is trying to address is just full transparency from the taxpayer. Currently, the way transfer pricing works in Latin America is just a one-sided approach. Why? Because most of the times, the entity that is being analyzed for transfer pricing purposes is the subsidiary, the Latin America subsidiary, without really allowing tax authority to see the overall picture. So what Action Plan 13 is trying to tackle is exactly that, that the tax authorities from Latin America or from other countries, they have a holistic view of what the multinational is doing in terms of business, in terms of functions, and then how a multinational is allocating their income, taxes and expenses across all the jurisdictions where a multinational operates. That's good. Of course, that's good, and that's in the benefit of all organizations and of all tax jurisdictions. But as we will see later, again, it creates a burden because the question right now from my clients is, well, first of all, which countries are actually implementing Action Plan 13? And if I operate in a country that is not implementing Action Plan 13, what should I do? Should I still doing my ad hoc country-by-country file every year, being inconsistent, paying high fees for that report, for updating the benchmarks? That's a key question.
And Abed, when I look at this transmission risk assessment procedures, they are very important and critical, especially in developing economies, emerging markets. Now, I have seen in many cases where the companies, the countries, they have a kind of a threshold, and especially in emerging markets, and if the value of cross-border transition is above threshold, they have to be compulsory picked up for audits. Now, and I see some hope now in CBIC, once we have CBIC, it can be a kind of an initial risk assessment tool for the tax authorities so that they can focus and they can use the resources in an optimal way. So do you think when we look at the current risk assessment process for picking up the audits in Latin America, do you think the CBIC would actually reduce the number of notices which go to the taxpayer, and so that the authorities, they focus their time and efforts on those cases where they think, yes, there's a problem, they will analyze it, and possibly if there's a problem, they will see a high success rate at appellate authorities so that the corporate's time is saved and at the same time the exchequer gets the right revenue which is needed for economy to grow?
Yeah, that's a very good question, and unfortunately, I think that the answer is no. I think that the implementation of Action Plan 13 across Latin America is just going to create a delay on how tax assessments are done by the tax authorities for just one reason. The majority of Latin American countries, they're not really that developed in the area of transfer pricing. There was a study published a few years ago about transfer pricing in LATAM and how developed it is. Where do transfer pricing audits in Latin America are focused, in which industries, what are the resources that tax authorities develop for performing a transfer pricing audit, the time spent, and so on. And the report didn't look good. It looks like it takes too long for a tax assessment, for transfer pricing assessment. It looks like tax authorities for the majority of these Latin countries are not really knowledgeable in terms of the international, what I call international transfer pricing. So not just focusing on the local regulations and what the local regulation says, but just, again, having an overall picture, the interrelation between the tested party and also the other parties of the group, which is what Action Plan is trying to do. Let's have a holistic view. So I think that if tax authorities from Latin America would get to have access to all this confidential and sensitive information from a multinational, I think it's just providing them with too much ammunition. Ammunition for them to interpret it the way they want it. But is it their mistake? Probably not. Because probably some of these jurisdictions, again, they do have no knowledge about transfer pricing. So they're not trained on transfer pricing. They don't understand the developments of transfer pricing. They're not even abide to follow the OECD.
Yeah, absolutely right, Albert. But I think at the same time, it will be very important for the global tax community, and especially the OECD has made efforts that there should be a strong dispute resolution platform, because just having Action Plan 13 and, you know, having C-by-C with relevant countries in specific region would obviously solve a purpose for initial risk assessment, and there will be some years before certain countries will mature up to the level where they can take the required decisions. But I think having right dispute resolution platform will be very important, especially in this type of region where they will have more data to look at it, and then there could be possibility of a higher level of tax disputes coming up in the future.
Indeed, indeed. I mean, the whole concept of the BEPS is cooperation amongst countries. That works in a EU context. Why? Because the whole concept of the EU. Perhaps it works for the US and Canada, because they are both countries who really work together, parallel to each other. Also for Australia, Japan. But what happens in Latin America is that it's just a region where each country looks for itself. There's not really that true cooperation. I mean, you have the Mercosur, and you have also the Latin America community, but they haven't really worked together, all these organizations. They come up with divisions. You have NAFTA, again, the Mercosur, and each of them have different tax benefits amongst each other, depending on which organization you are part of. So if we're trying to implement, again, BEPS for whole Latin America, what are the chances that the whole Latin America region would really start working together to cooperate amongst them in the context of what you're saying in terms of assessments? What would be the chance that would be that among tax Latin American countries they will be exchanging information and simplifying the whole process if they don't even have experience that much in transfer pricing? You have tax authorities, for instance, from Mexico, you have tax authorities from Argentina, from Brazil, from Chile. Again, those are the countries that, according to the report, they are developed, at least way more ahead and other Latin American Caribbean countries. So perhaps amongst them, they can come up with a plan to work together. Also in Peru, Peru is again trying to work. Colombia is trying to be part of the OECD. Costa Rica is trying to be part of the OECD. So maybe I can see in the near future, 5 years, perhaps some cooperation amongst them. But there are 26 countries. What's going to happen with those 26? Maybe they're just going to have to follow those five. So if we take into account what we just discussed,
just before we move to the next slide, one point was really striking me is that when I look at the layer of documentation now, we have four layers of documentation, three proposed by the given by the OECD, and fourth already we have local TP forms. And somewhere my experience has been that at TPA, when we assist clients, we generally have an approach where we have a risk matrix, which is quite scientific and automated, which tells companies that, hey, you have to file this form on so-and-so date because you know that there are penal consequences, you have to pay penalty. We also have a calendar which gives the deadline for documentation. So what's your take now that we have a very well-defined layers of documentation by the OECD? So where do you see that, you know, today the way we have clients on having those automated calendars, having a transmitting risk matrix which can keep control so that the companies, the MNCs, complying with the regulations of compliance, otherwise they're going to have penalty. So do you think that given now it's more organized, but you know, given by the OECD, do you think the relevance of such a risk matrix tool will be all the more important in the future now?
It is certainly for planning. You know, if you remember the first slide that I showed, you have four layers within an organization. So there needs to be communication. That's key between them, and also the perception of what each of these layers is doing, also the expectations. So somehow there needs to be a tool that an organization should use to plan amongst what needs to be done for Latin America. And as we're going to see later, there's nothing that much concrete on what Latin America will do around Action Plan 13. So you need to use the information that has been published thus far by the OECD, by the G20 community, by the Latin American countries within that context of Action Plan 13, and just work your head around. The thing is that there's so much information in place that my clients cannot keep up with it. And that's when they contact us, and then we come up with a series of tools that we, based upon our knowledge of the regulations in place and the developments of these Latin American countries around BEPS, and also just around their general transfer pricing rules, we try to come up with a matrix that, like you mentioned, it helps them plan. In the end, it's just about planning. And that was one of the key four boxes that I also showed in the first line. It's about long-term planning. So the effect of that tool will take into account, for instance, what we can see in this slide, which is which of the Latin American countries have been growing faster in the area of transfer pricing. At the top of this chart, you can see, for instance, Argentina, Mexico, and Brazil being the pioneers. They have more than 20 years of transfer pricing. So you can foresee, again already, that these three countries will start doing something around BEPS. Mexico has already done it, and next year, most likely, CBC will kick in. But then Brazil, we already discussed. I don't really see Brazil doing anything around Action Plan 13. But Argentina is a G20 member. So that means that they want to participate, they want to be active, and we know that the Argentinian economy is not doing good. Could it be due to tax evasion? Is there another way to simplify the transfer pricing system? Okay, maybe they're going to be looking at what Mexico does and how the implementation of Action Plan 13 works in Mexico, and maybe Argentina would just be reacting. Then we see in the second layer, we see Colombia, for instance, and Colombia is an accession country. Chile is already part of an OECD member. Then if we focus on the third layer, we have Costa Rica. They also try to be part of the OECD. Peru is, again, is holding regional meetings for all Latin American countries. So for BEPS discussions. And then you have the last two layers, countries that are trying to grow little by little in the area of transfer pricing. Why? Because they've noticed that a lot of tax leakage is done through transfer pricing. The problem is that these economies, sometimes they live from commodities or they live for very particular industries, which they cannot be too aggressive, again, in the area of corporate taxes. And BEPS is, again, about addressing corporate taxes. So if they try to implement, these countries at the bottom of the layer, they try to implement aggressive BEPS measures, there are high chances then that their investors will be moving to other Latin American countries or perhaps to Asia. Asia is a region that is growing. Africa and some regions are also growing. So that's what these countries are right now, a little bit sensitive on how to implement BEPS action plans just in general. And again, in terms of Action Plan 13, again, you can expect something to be done for layer number one. Mexico is doing it. Again, layer two and three. I wouldn't be surprised if in the next 2 or 3 years you see something coming in.
But, you know, when I look at especially the evolution of transfer pricing in emerging markets, especially I spent many years in India, I would see that like in India it's almost 15 years now. Initial 5 years, you know, everybody was having knowledge. Tax authorities, they were coming up to the catching up with the knowledge. They were getting high on the learning curve. In the second 5 years, which is from 2005 to 2010, we saw a lot of tax TP disputes coming up. But when I look at on your previous slides, where Argentina, Mexico, Brazil, they have 20 years of experience. And then when I go further down, we have countries like Bolivia, Guatemala, where we have 5 years or less experience. But then there is, as I mentioned to you, that there's a stage where the countries become very aggressive because they're catching up with knowledge, but you know, for them, TP tool is something new. Not very new, it's almost 4 or 5 years. So do you think once CBC is in the hands of these various countries in Latin America, do you see more disputes coming from specific set of countries where they have not so many years of experience? Because if you have less number of years of experience in transfer pricing, your infrastructure to handle transfer pricing is not so developed. So is it right to say that we can see more disputes in those countries where they have, say, less than or around 5 years of experience in transfer pricing?
Well, the thing is that these countries are at the bottom of the table, and they're actually not really active even on the audits per se. not even just on general transfer pricing. So whether Action Plan 13 is or not implemented in their own jurisdictions, I don't think it's going to change, because again, they have other priorities, and transfer pricing, again, it can actually backfire because it can scare foreign direct investment. So probably they just focus on compliance. Did you prepare the report? Did you file it? In Bolivia, as in other Central American countries, transfer pricing has finally become a law. So that means that companies will have to comply on an annual basis in documenting the transfer prices. In some of these countries, you have to submit a transfer pricing report. So again, we go back to the same, it's just compliance, it's just cost, it is a burden. And if you have 26 Latin American countries, and then we see from this table that a few, it's just about, do you have to report? And there's also the transfer pricing forms, which is the fourth layer of CBC. In some of these transfer pricing forms, there is a box where you need to check, did I prepare transfer pricing documentation, yes or no? Which transfer pricing method did you use? What would be, what was the margin that was obtained on each of the intercompany transactions? If you have to do this for, let's say, 15 of countries where a multinational operates, and if those 15 countries, there are at least two subsidiaries, sounds like a lot of work. So going back to your point, can we expect because of that a lot of audits? Maybe not, but what you can expect is in the event of an audit, it will take time. It will not be easy to negotiate. Most likely these countries will go, and because of the lack of solid knowledge of international transfer pricing, they will be very biased on their conclusions. And APAs is not really something, it's not a tool that you can really implement across LATAM. It works for other developed countries, again, North America, European, but not really in Latin America. So, and transfer pricing adjustment, compensating adjustment, again, it just doesn't work. It doesn't work thus far. So there's not too much information. Tax authorities don't know about it. So there's a lot of questions. Okay, what can I do? What can a taxpayer do given the lack of knowledge, the lack of evolution in the area of transfer pricing? And if at some point Action Plan 13 hits in, is it going to change? Again, my answer is I don't think so.
And possibly, Evert, I think you could throw more light when we are on the slides of you know, having a master file type of concept for Latin America. They are possibly having that unified file for Latin America could possibly resolve, you know, these risk areas where we have these countries where for them foreign direct investment is important, but they're not high on the learning curve. They can be biased on their decision making, but if we have that unified for master file concept, that would possibly help them, which you can cover later.
It is correct, Rand, and just if we focus on the slide that we're showing now on the screen, it's actually what you just addressed, which is the Latin Master File. You know, we just already talked about where the tax authorities across Latin are, the majority of them, because again, there are always exceptions. We already mentioned the countries that have a more developed sense of international transfer pricing, but not because Latin America is not that developed in international transfer pricing, not because of the lack of knowledge of the tax inspectors, not because of the lack of implementation of Action Plan 13 or any BEPS measurement. That doesn't mean that a multinational should be scared about it. That's why we're here, and that's the whole purpose of this webinar. What can we do given those limitations? And that's what we can see in this slide. What TPA is proposing is, let's come up with a Latin master. As we saw on one of the first slides, Action Plan 13 is about three layers primarily. First, the master file, just the global master file. Then you have the country files, and then the CBC report. Then some of my clients will be asking, well, why would I like to have a Latin master file? Well, the reason is if you only have a global master file, most likely it's going to be in English. In Latin America, most tax administrations do not accept other languages other than Spanish, which is the most common language spoken in Latin America, except for Brazil, which is Portuguese. Again, most tax authorities would not accept a report being prepared in English. Some of them actually are quite aggressive, and even if a taxpayer has a report prepared in English for a Latin America subsidiary, a tax administration take that as, if the report's in English, tax administration would take it as not compliant, and there's already a penalty for that. So I think that it's important to take that small but important factor into account, which is come up with a master file that addresses Latin America, that is first in Spanish. Then the second point to take into account is that the number of databases, so how to support the transfer prices. If you try to use information produced elsewhere in Europe or North America, it doesn't necessarily mean that it will work for Latin America. Latin America tax administrations, they have their own databases, acceptable list of databases, and these databases focus on emerging markets, which is what you're referring to. And emerging markets can be Latin America, that would be their preferred region, but also perhaps they can accept from other emerging markets in Asia.
Abbott, this looks like a good proposition to me. You know, if I'm a CFO, if I look from a CFO perspective, that instead of preparing documentation of 20 countries, I prepare a Latin TP master file, and which would possibly align with my global TP master file. But then my next question will be that, can this Latin master file help me in TP audits if I have, say, operation in 20 countries? So rather than preparing 20 TP local files, and you know, I multiply the X amount of the money I pay, if I prepare Latin TP master file, do you think that can really help me in taking my cases when if I get a TP audit, while keeping in mind that under Action Plan 13, we will have a master file which will more about documenting TP policies, the value chain, and other things, and then I will have a local file. So do you think this latent TP master file, although more important now, especially after BEPS Action 13, which as a CFO can also help in controlling their budget, but not at the risk of potential TP adjustments from the Latin American tax authorities because I didn't prepare all local files?
Yeah, at least the reason why it's important on having a Latin master file, you can certainly not use it as your evidence to support the transfer pricing. If you show them a master file with the title on the front page saying master file, there are high chances that the tax administration in Latin America, they won't like it. But the relevance of the Latin master file comes in because you will leverage 80 or 70% of the information that contains that master file to produce your local files. And the local files, then you can produce them in 3 to 5 business days. Usually right now, most multinationals, perhaps those who are just stepping into the area of transfer pricing and trying to be TP compliant around the world, you will see that, you know, the local consultants take sometimes 1 month or 2 months to prepare it. You have to do the interviews, you have to review the financial statements, you need to identify approaches to support the transfer prices. There are a series of discussions with the regional headquarters, with the subsidiary, with the global headquarters. It just takes too much time. In the event of an audit, sometimes tax administrations, they give you only 30 days to produce it. Well, how do you do it that in 2 months? You can't. So at least with a master file, what you can do is, again, you can significantly leverage from that master file. By leverage, I mean copy and paste. So you copy the information from the Latin master file, you put it in the country file, you just make reference to the specific end business entity for which the local transfer report is being prepared to. You also have in the master file already the benchmarks that you know that are Latin, acceptable for Latin purposes. In Latin America, tax administration also expect some capital adjustments, you know, which in other developed countries, such type of adjustments just don't take place. So those are the more things. It's a matter about time, it's a matter about knowledge, and also about consistency. How are you going to apply it? So the importance of having this master file, again, because you can use it to just copy and paste. Also, the master file will cover the most fundamental intercompany transactions. Most companies in Latin America, they are subsidiaries, and they do either contract manufacturing, or they act as full-fledgers, or they act as commissioners, limited risk distributors. They receive also licenses of some IP, of some intercompany loans also. So if it is possible to spot a trend in all these subsidiaries where the multinational operates, then we can create in the master file already modules, a module covering each specific type of functional profile, either if a company is a manufacturer, distributor, and so on, so that whenever the country file needs to be prepared, it's just a matter again of copy and pasting. If an entity is a contract manufacturer, there will be already a module covering the functional profile.
Yeah. This looks very interesting. You know, if I can leverage 80% from the Latin TP master file, and if I have operations in 20 countries in Latin America, so if I have to do local, just up to 20%, so I can be actually preparing full files for only 4 countries, right? So I can say, so 20% of 20 is 4 countries, and I have 1 Latin my file, so which I can leverage. And I think it's all the more important now because under that Action Plan 13, they're clearly saying that about having the preparation of local files now, right? So all most of the countries, they will be very clearly aware of the local file requirement. It's only the timing when they will ask from the taxpayer. But I think if I can save 80% of my cost, so having operation in 20 countries, I can just prepare for four. Kind of cost I'm going to incur will be only for four, and then later in master file I can use it.
That is correct, and if we follow that rationale, then the question is, if the audience can recognize the benefit of having the last known master file, then the question, where should I start? Which Latin American country should serve as the base case to create that master file? And then, you know, I would suggest to do Mexico for just one specific reason. Mexico is an OECD member country. Mexico is, again, along with Australia, with Argentina and Brazil, the top three Latin countries that pioneer in the area of international transfer pricing. And just recently, in September, Mexico has finally proposed to Congress the implementation of Action Plan 13. So that means that Mexico will be the first and only country by the end of this year, that's very likely, that will have finally implemented explicit in its law, CYC, and the master file, the requirement to file a master file, the requirement to file a country file, the CBC reporting, and then the local transfer pricing filings. So if a multinational can use Mexico again as the base case, I think that makes a lot of sense. There's another reason. Mexico has very specific regulations in terms of how to produce a transfer pricing report. A transfer pricing report should have a company information, it should have the industry information, addressing Latin America, not just the industry worldwide, but also Latin America or Mexico in this specific case. It needs to have an analysis of all the intercompany transactions that a taxpayer has engaged in a fiscal year, all of them, regardless of their volume, according to the local law. But of course, you know, sometimes you need to be practical on that. And then the economic analysis, so how to support the transfer prices, they also need to be done on a transaction-by-transaction basis. Mexico, most of the times, serves against a platform to do business in Latin America. So multinationals start first doing business in Mexico, and then they, if it works, they start moving to all Latin American countries. So if we take those factors into account, then my suggestion would be prepare a master file that is very close to compliance with Mexican TP purposes and also around Action Plan 13. If you can do that, then it's just a matter of converting that master file into modules. Again, a module for a contract manufacturer, distributor, commissioner. But again, it will already have a local flavor, which is the Latin America flavor, which is what tax authorities see. I've seen audits where the taxpayer produces a file that it sounds like a global master file. And it sounds like it's really a template coming from the headquarters. Immediately, tax inspectors are already thinking, this taxpayer is trying to commit easy, and it cannot be like that. So it's not a good way to start negotiations as defending your transfer pricing vis-a-vis the tax authorities. So that's why you need to come up with a file that has, again, as I said, the local flavor, that you know it is compliant at least for one big Latin American country, which is Mexico. And then you know that this report is already in Spanish, so you can easily replicate it in other countries where you operate. And then what Mexico doesn't cover yet in its legislation is the sixth method. And I think that's what a lot of companies have been addressing. Companies will need to follow the sixth method. The sixth method covers commodity transactions. What should be the solution? My solution would be, well, take into account Argentina. So in that master file, if your company is engaged in commodity transactions, let's use Argentina. Let's use Argentina's legislation or even Uruguay legislation around commodities and come up with a section of the report that addresses commodity transactions. We develop a transfer pricing approach to substantiate the transfer prices and also to document the transfer prices. So, and you can see this in this slide. So by producing a report, a Latin American master file based upon a Latin American countries, we see a high level of consistency across the organization for all the Latin American operations. It's becoming cost effective, which is what you were addressing, the CFO concern. Is it effective? Yes, it will be cost effective. And then it will be consistent. Because these days, again, multinationals, they're using sometimes different tax advisors, different transfer pricing advisors. And I've seen reports with completely different stories. Transfer pricing is just about storytelling. and that doesn't look good. BEPS is about, again, being coordinated, being cooperative, sharing information. So if that information is ever shared with all the tax administrations, not just for Latin America, but outside of the Latin America region, there are high chances of inconsistencies.
Yep.
Maybe there's a good reason behind those inconsistencies, but trying to explain all of them to a tax inspector, running out of time, you need to pay the hourly fee rate to your tax advisors, it's becoming costly.
And thanks, Abed. This is very useful. Another important point I have is that benchmarking is kind of a very important part of the Masterfile. And given your experience, do you think we can use kind of a regional benchmark, but then it will give a kind of a range of markups? And then do you think the regional benchmark can address most of the countries in Latin America? Because if I prepare a Masterfile, I don't want to have, say, different benchmarks for different countries, because I can have one storyline where I have function analysis explained for the whole Latin America region, but benchmarking is also important. So, as you mentioned that, you know, they're kind of a one kind of, not exactly kind of common database, unified database which can be used. So, do you think even benchmarking front we can be efficient?
It can be done. It can be done in a cost-effective manner. Why? Because tax administrations across Latin, they are two broad categories of databases that they primarily use. One, the first one is Orbis, that's probably used for Central and South America, but then Mexico is considered more to be part of NAFTA, and because of that they use CompuStat or can CompuStat, merge it, disclosure, but even tax administrations from Latin America, from South America, Central America, they also are open to take those references from those databases into account. So again, we're trying to make the whole world simple, which is let's produce benchmarks using those databases, either Orbis or Disclosure or CompuStat, and based upon that information, you produce regional benchmarks that you know that are acceptable across Latin America. If you need to apply capital adjustments, you can also apply them. You can come up with a section on the report disclosing how to apply that information, who should provide that information, the methodology. Again, it's about consistency. That's what we're trying to approach. And one of the key questions that you were addressing, Brian, and I think this is important, is there a way so that the audience can quantify the benefits of having this Latin America Masterfile? And basically, we can see it here. I mean, I just took as an estimate of how much it costs to produce just one Masterfile, first of all. And we can see it there. It's just based on an estimate. But then if a company has, let's say, four subsidiaries in Latin America, and there are four intercompany transactions that need to be documented for each subsidiary, then we see that the estimated cost would be between $30,000 and $60,000 in a year. And then that makes it a total of producing Masterfile plus the local files between $80,000 and $130,000. If we focus just on the country documentation, and again, taking account that in most Latin American countries, this has to be done on an annual basis. In some countries, you need to submit the report to the tax administration. In others, you just need to prepare it and have it in hand in case it's being required. That means that are you going to multiply $30,000 to $60,000 for every single year? For the CFO, you know, he's going crazy. Compliance is just cost. Is there a way to minimize it? And that's what we think that by implementing the Latin American Masterfile, that can be a significant reduction in those costs. We've done it in the past. So we can see that we have been tracking that reduction. So in the first year is the year of investment. And as the audience knows, when investment means putting a lot of money in the first year of operations. And you can see on the second column, labeled it first year, the developing of the base case. The developing of the base case means developing the Masterfile, the Latin Masterfile. So probably there's not going to be a significant change in cost between that first year. But then if we focus on the second year, it's maintaining that Masterfile. What does that mean? If we produce a solid Latin American Masterfile in year one, then year two is just about updating. It's just about having a chat with your with the regional head of transfer of tax of that of a multinational, and just asking about any potential changes in the operations of the group, or the industry, or the transfer prices, or the operations of the subsidiaries. If there are any changes, what you need to the Latin America Masterfile will need to be updated. But most of the times it's just a few lines. You don't need to update everything. So because of that, you can see already on year two a significant reduction, especially in the master file, because the master file is just a few general sections, but also in the country files. Because on the country files, you're just extracting information from the master file. So the time spent on producing the local file should be less. Also in year two, there's already a strong communication and level of trust between the advisor also and the taxpayer, which is you already understand expectations, what your client expectations is, the level of communication that you should have, the consistency that you should have, and also the long-term plans of the taxpayer. Finally, we focus on year three. Most of the times what we've seen is you don't have to update anything. It's just advisory work. So you don't focus anymore on the compliance part, but we finally strike bringing some benefit to the table, which is let's do some reorganization around it. How can we do your organization more effective? Can we maximize your ETR? You know, the CFO likes the maximization, optimization of the ETR. If you are a taxpayer, if you are in one of these levels of the organization, again, you can see the benefits of implementing the LATAM master file. If you're the CFO, again, you can see a reduction of your of the cost of compliance of between 60 to 70%. If you are the tax director, optimizing the ETR. If you are an e-health transfer passing manager, well, the production of the country files, you can do it in 3 to 5 days, whereas opposed to waiting for 1 or 2 months to produce it. And finally, if we pull out all these layers and we look at the upper part, then we have the stakeholders, we have the board of directors. Those are the faces to the market. If the first, if the bottom layers feeling confident about we have a solid file that accurately reflects what the organization does for a whole region, the documentation has been produced in a consistent and cost-effective manner, and it easily describes how we do business in compliance with local regulations and also in compliance with other stakeholders. And the board of directors, the stockholders, will feel confident about that organization where they're putting their money. And then the whole machine just starts working easily by itself.
And I think it's very important, the cost savings. As a CFO, I'll be very mindful of how much budget I allocate for this compliance. But at the same time, I will be very conscious that what I produce now should have a consistent message, you know, on pricing. So if I look at my say 20 country operation in Latin America, if I have 20 different policies, I'm benchmarking them separately. I would prefer to have a kind of a master file approach, which will give a consistent message. And given that we have C by C reporting, there will be high chance that if the company is not complying with the principle, it could get a tax notice from the tax authority. So if today I have a unified master file kind of approach, that will also address my tax audit assessment, which may happen post BEPS. So I would rather see that this master file, not only from cost saving, obviously it saves my cost I pay to consultants, it also saves the time my own people spend their efforts on preparing as working with consultants. And then thirdly, the most important is that it will also help me in defending my case if tomorrow there's any audit happens.
Indeed, I mean, if the implementation of action plan, let's assume that it happens across all Latin American countries, if we can all acknowledge that it will be just about compliance, then like we said, it's about cost. And at least the implementation of the Latin master file can lower the cost, as we have shown. Of course, you cannot do it in year one, but if you think about 3 or 4 years, then you can see a huge reduction in the cost. As you mentioned, if it's also about communication and the level of involvement from all the levels of organization to produce a master file, then again, people can start focusing at some point on other key issues to the organization. Not just about complying with something, but it's more about how can we go around those measurements that we need to comply to and bring a business benefit organically, or again, expanding operations and so on, reducing the amount of debt, and maximizing the dividends of your stockholders, stakeholders, and so on. So that's what we decided to come up and share this this solution to our audience. I hope that they were able to understand the relevance of having the LATAM master file, which country should be the basis for producing that LATAM master file, and then what should be the content of the LATAM master file.
I think one important point which I saw in actual BEPS section 10.13 is that it also says that the country doesn't have to prepare full-blown documentation every year. So they say that it should be more like a review subsequent year if business doesn't change much, function, they don't change much. And then even on comparable financials, after three years, you rerun your search, but you just need to update your financials. So when I look at the chart which you shared on the cost savings, it perfectly matches with what Action 13 expect, where first year, yes, we make investment, but then subsequent years, if you follow this master file concept, then we only have to renew, or in the third year, it would be more like advisory, where we don't actually, the client is not actually required to prepare a full-blown report. It just need to talk to their consultant on the relevant transitioning area wherever they need any assistance.
That is correct, Ryan. And just my final remark is actually when we have reached year three with our clients are actually doing the reports by themselves. And sometimes they just send us the report, we give them a review, just clean a few comments, and that's it. But then we start planning. Year three and onwards, so it's about, and perhaps in year four and five, you can do a full update of the master file. But maybe it's not necessary because, again, in the maintenance period, you're always doing it. I think that from my end, Fiona, that's it. And are there any questions?
Not necessarily a question, but we got a comment regarding Brazil. The commentator says the country is in recession, not just slow down of growth.
That is correct. I mean, at least it is not a recession, because a recession means that it's a huge impact on its financial. It is not growing as fast as before. Now it's growing, or is expected to end up growing at the rate of 3%. But is that a recession? As far as I recollect, it is not a recession. It's just growing not as fast as before. But it's certainly, again, down for the economy, because then the amount of taxes that the Brazil is getting from multinational business is not as before, and that slows down the whole growth. Maybe at some point it can enter a recession.
But if I look at this comment, I think this is a very important comment. It's a very important comment because when I see, whenever the economy is in recession or in slow growth, then it becomes all the more important for tax authorities to ensure that the MNCs, they pay right taxes, you know, which are due to the country. And in those cases, as we discussed, that we have those fixed markup system in place, safe harbors type of mechanism in place. I'm not very confident that pricing mechanism will change, because if you move to, say, from a cost plus 15, you move to a flexible pricing model, and then MNCs would possibly report the different markups, which, for example, arm's length required to just for cost plus 5, then, you know, I would just imagine that Brazil would be hit more, because they have to have tax revenue, which will actually fuel growth, to push growth in the future. So where do you see, given this kind of slowdown in Brazil, it can also happen in other countries,
yeah,
where do you see that changes in the pricing policy which the Brazilian tax authorities have adopted for so many years?
I don't see a significant change on that, with the specific reason is they have, again, a set of parameters that of markups that multinationals need to apply depending on if it's an export or import transaction. So, again, they're being very protectionistic. Are they going to change those margins? Maybe they're going to decrease it, or maybe the cost rate that should be comprising to calculate those markups? Maybe. But have we seen it now? Has the government announced anything? No. As I mentioned, they have announced measurements in the area of the company financing, or even third-party financing, but nothing with respect to the margins, the established margins that the local legislation establishes.
All right. Thank you, Heber. Thank you, Virendra, for this very informative webinar. Now, if there are no questions, we would like to end the session. Thank you very much to everyone who participated. The slides and the recording of this webinar can be downloaded from tpa-global.com, and they will be available in the next half an hour. Thank you very much for participation.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Heber.